Excellent. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. And it's an honor to be the last speaker of today, as well as I'm a non-engineer, so this is going to be exciting for you guys, I hope. I'm a conservationist by heart, and just to set the scene a little bit, I would like you to listen very carefully to the next soundbite. You would think that it's just a bird singing. It is the Hawaii O'o bird. And this song is the last male of its species calling for a female that will never come. After this fragment, the bird got extinct, and we would lose this species forever, as extinction is forever. And that makes you think about the importance of protecting our biodiversity, not just for our pleasure, but when we lose an animal species, we lose a unique perspective to this planet, which is lost forever. And just to give you a bit more background on where we stand on protecting biodiversity, at the moment, the current rate of how we see species getting killed and slaughtered and poached is you have 1,000 rhinos annually, where they use the powder of the horn for traditional Chinese medicine. They say it cures cancer, or they use it as a party drug. At the moment, per gram, it's worth more than gold. Elephants, we lose over 30,000 elephants each year, where the tusks are being used to make jewelry and stuff like that. And I don't know if maybe you have seen this one or you haven't. It's a skilled anteater, but also called a pangolin. And this animal is the world's most trafficked animal in the world. Over 1 million each year are being poached and sold on the black market. So I personally find it very important to see if we can protect our natural world. But I was a former law enforcer and for the Dutch police. So where does my link with the technology come in? Well, that started here in the Antarctic, where I joined one of the anti-whaling vessels of a conservation organization called Sea Shepherd. And each year we had to go after the illegal whaling fleet, and we used old ships to find them. It took forever. And then one year we said, okay, how about we start using this one? It was called the Adi Gil, a trimaran, a wave piercer. We were able to get to Antarctica within 5 days. It was super fast. Before that, it circumnavigated the globe in 60 days on biofuel. And we did. We found the whaling fleet way more faster than previous years. And we were able to stop them and stop whaling. And then, you know, when you're successful, you're pissing someone off. And in that case, it was the whalers who were illegally there. And they decided to do the following. They cut our ship in half, and it's a few hours after this, it sunk in the middle of the Antarctic Ocean. But it showed that we did something effective. And it made me think of, if we can be so effective, then what can other technology mean for conservation? So I went with a group of people, we sat down and said, maybe we can start, and this is early 2011, what could we achieve with drone technology? Nowadays, drone technology is getting there, but in 2011, it meant almost gluing a wooden drone together with a big camera on the... Oh, here you go. So we used this one in Namibia to film illegal culling of seals, what they do there. Barely anyone knows it, but about 90,000 seals each year are being clubbed in Namibia. And we wanted to get images before getting caught by the security guard. So we thought, okay, let's see if we can start using drones. So we camped out in the Namib Desert, and we started to use this drone that we called the Jimi Hendrix, and it gave us an image, but that was it. It wasn't as good as we thought it was, but it was 2011. It was early day drones, and we managed to get this out there, but at least we could tell the story. That's almost half as important as doing the actual job, is getting the story out there and convince people that there is a poaching problem. But while we're in Africa, I got really intrigued by the rhino poaching problem, because it is not just a few people poaching animals. It's especially the rhino culling industry is so massive. It's really organized crime that brings in billions of dollars each year. And we thought, maybe with this drone technology, we can start making a difference and find those poachers. And we started in South Africa. And we had the first success. In one of the reserves, we were the first to actually find rhino poachers in the middle of the night. There's still a video clip out there that you can see where we apprehend them, and it becomes a shootout, and the poachers, they get killed. And that really brought it home that this is such dangerous work to get involved in. But the drones, they showed some effect. But there was one problem with drones, and for you people who might be here that have a drone that you use as a hobby, you might have come across it. But especially when you're working in Africa in very remote, vast areas, and there's a lot of dust and harsh conditions, occasionally you come across the following. Drones crash. And they crash an awful lot. So, okay, we had the passion to use technology for the greater good. So that side was covered. But with the technology we had, wasn't quite there yet. And you know, if you look at this image, I believe it's one of the parks in Malawi where we work. If you want to be efficient, you have to cover enormous areas. And so what do you need? You need a low power wireless area network. And that's when Jeroen, one of the co-founders here today as well, and Tim, they joined the team. And we sat down and say, OK, how can we convince park owners in Africa to start adapting that technology? Because by then, they had, you know, the whole book was thrown at them, because everybody was calling drones and everybody was talking technology. And still, in the end, these guys were still losing animals every day. And they weren't so happy about using technologies or paying, you know, large amounts of money for it. So we had to crack one of the puzzles in the anti-poaching world. And one of them was the rhino sensor. For many years, they've been using the RF tags, and they try to do them in the horn, or they try to use necklaces. That didn't all quite work. What we wanted to do is get a LoRa-enabled tracker in the horn. So we decided to start designing it. Now, on the left, you see one of the first prototypes. Had the GPS module on it. And we took it to one of the vets who was going to implement it. And it was, you know, we're super excited, and we're going to make this happen. And he goes, yeah, way too big. That is never going to work. And they're like, oh, OK, so we have to get back to the drawing board and, you know, take out as much as the battery. It's about 90-95% of it is battery. We have to take that out and try it again. But then still, with the GPS, we didn't have enough fixes to make it really work. So we called in the help of the Semtech guys. And they helped us to start using it with triangulation. And we went back to Tanzania, where we did the first deployment. And we installed it in the horn. And ever since, for over 2 years now, we've been receiving a location update every 7 minutes. It's fantastic to know what that means for a reserve, because once you know where your animal is, you can start, okay, how do we need to patrol at night? Do we need to deploy the rangers in a certain way? How can we keep the animals safe? So all this kind of information leads to more situational awareness. And just to give you an idea of the capabilities that we decided, okay, so we did it with a rhino. Now let's see, how can we work with helping these parks in other ways? A short animation about it. So we started in Tanzania, and what we provide the whole solution. So we do the network analysis, then we start building the gateways, putting the sensors on there. We help the park with putting the sensors in the field, and then we made our own application as well to bring back all the data. The end of 2017, we had the 80 square kilometers coverage in Tanzania. Then one of the other things we did was we went to India, where we won the Human Wildlife Tech Challenge. A lot of the times they have elephants coming into a certain area and they break through the fences. With sensor technology, we could see, okay, when are they coming through the fences? And once they are gone through a fence, how can we get an alarm activated to warn the rangers that are at the control post? Now, one of the next steps we want to do is make sure that local villagers or local farmers, they immediately get an SMS or text or whatever to warn them that a trampling elephant is coming their way. And that is one of the next things we want to try and achieve. So from Mukomazi, we had to scale it up. We had to showcase that we could do it on a large scale. And that is where we went to Akagera in Rwanda, covering over 1,100 square kilometers. We went to Malawi in Liwanda. And one of the next things we're going to do is in Morocco, where you have little sand cats. But they can't have a fixed infrastructure. So what we designed is a mobile gateway that they can take into the field and find the locations that way. So here you see the coverage. Now, from the people who are from the Netherlands, in little over a year, we've covered an area that's as big as the province of South Holland. So we're pretty proud of it. And with over 65 rhinos, pretty much under our management, together with the park, of course, but with our technology. And now we've also have collared cheetahs, elephants, hyenas, and many more species to come and keeping them safe. And the thing is, okay, so what have you achieved? Which is the million-dollar question we get all the time, is, well, in two of the parks that we're working, and where we're working the longest, poaching has actually dropped to zero. Now, I cannot say, because it wouldn't be fair to say that's just due to our technology, but we've made a big dent in the whole problem. So it's a solution that the whole park has to work on, but technology has shown that it makes a difference, and we're incredibly proud of that. But then another question that we got asked very often is, okay, really nice project, guys, how do you pay the bills? Like, you can't live off of doing this kind of cool stuff, and so who's going to pay for it? Well, in the end of 2017, there was one of us pretty much doing it part-time, and two guys doing it on the side and having quite a few volunteers. But we changed the structure a bit. So at the moment, all three of us are doing this full-time, and we've got many people supporting us. Because what we did is, okay, one hand, we have the foundation, and the foundation is raising funds for grants or high net worth individuals that want to help us and make these projects possible. Now, on the other hand, we created the limited, so larger organizations or larger park owners, they can actually pay for the solution. The ones that pay for the solution, the money that we get from those, we try to keep developing the technology and the solution, but also try to help the smaller parks. Because in the end, what we want to achieve is have as much technology as possible being used for keystone species. And by keystone species, I mean species like the elephant. Because these are the true engineers of nature. And they come in and they rip out the trees and they leave footprints and other smaller animals can live in that and can thrive and flourish and survive. So, and even the rhino nowadays, scientists have found out that just because of their grazing, they landscape the area in a way that other species can survive there. So these are essential to focus on. Now here's a little showcase video of the area that we used in Rwanda. So this is the park and how we set it up, and Tim, one of the engineers, is going to explain how we did it.
Akagera National Park, managed by African Parks, is Central Africa's largest protected wetland and the last remaining refuge for savanna-adapted species in Rwanda, home to more than 8,000 large mammals and 500 bird species. Unfortunately, some of these animals, like the elephant, are disappearing rapidly because of the increased amount of heavy poaching across the globe. The rhinos already disappeared, but were reintroduced recently. In order to improve wildlife protection, ShadowView introduces Smart parks. Since most national parks have no basic internet coverage, we start by covering the conservation area to collect data from sensors we distribute across the park.
Wat we hier doen is een opstelpunt maken van het LoRa-netwerk midden in Akashiera National Park. Wat we doen is een verbinding leggen met de andere opstelpunten totdat we bij het hoofdkwartier komen, de control room. Wij zetten daar dan in eerste instantie antennes in. Dat is een LoRa-antenne en dat zijn wifi-antennes. Zo hebben we dus hier signaal voor het hele gebied met het LoRa-netwerk.
We provide sensors to securely track wildlife, rangers, vehicles and anyone entering the fenced area. And we also install gate sensors.
Ze hebben, voordat we hier kwamen, hebben ze een mast gebouwd. Wij hebben de punten aangewezen. Dit zijn de hoogste punten. Waarmee we in eerste instantie alle voertuigen gaan tracken. En in het later stadium dus ook de neushoorn, de leeuw, de olifant. En eigenlijk alle andere dieren of voertuigen die ze willen volgen.
These guys, they are really perfect. When we started working together up to now, they don't even have time to waste. They are always from morning up to later hours. They have a purpose why they are here in Africa.
In the patrol, we use the car. Sometimes we use the helicopter to arrive in the area very difficult, and we do the patrol for foot patrol. When we find the poachers, we arrest them. We send them on the police, and the police send on the court.
By placing location trackers on endangered animals in the park, their position will be shown on the map in the control room. The data is processed and presented in an easy-to-use web application. This is called situational awareness and is very important in modern wildlife conservation. With locations updated every minute, the rangers are able to detect threats more easily. The heat map functionality provides a valuable view on the long-term roaming areas of the animals, tourists, and park personnel, which is important for park management and overall security.
Nou, wat we doen voordat we alles de mast inbrengen, is eigenlijk alles testen. In dit geval is het belangrijk dat de zenders het doen. En de kast, daar zit eigenlijk alle actieve apparatuur in. En die zorgt dat alles samenkomt. Daar zit ook stroom in, zit een accu in. En dat de kabel nog heel is. Je kunt je voorstellen dat met alle transport hier over deze wegen, dat die apparatuur veel klappen krijgt. Dus we testen alles voordat we weggaan en voordat het de mast ingaat, checken we alles. Meten we alles door en ook als het hangt, meten we alles door. En richten we alle antennes uit, kijken we of we goed bereik hebben. En ja, dit is nummertje 6 en we gaan er nog 3 doen.
Since 2016, ShadowView has already improved wildlife protection and park management in 2 national parks. With your support, ShadowView can turn more.
So this was how we did it in Rwanda. But what's next for us? And I think you've heard a lot of information here today. And what's critical for us is that we're not always interested in what's possible or what's exciting, but we really need stuff that actually works in the park. Because these park rangers and park managers, they cannot afford to experiment with technology. So that's always why we're very careful. But there are very exciting things coming up. And one of the things we're working with Lacuna Space on is, of course, if an animal gets out of a certain area, out of our fixed infrastructure, we still want to have somewhat of a connection. So that's one of the next steps we'll be evolving. And then we have the intelligence edge, where we still want to bring in like smart cameras. But then you have the challenge of the power supply, which is not always going to be efficient enough to use it. So there's many challenges. And if there's people out there that really are excited about this and want to help us, and then definitely shout out to us and come along, because we're looking for these kind of partnerships. And talking about partnerships, I'm really excited to announce one of the things we're going to launch today is the Open Collar Initiative. We noticed that the collar industry for collaring animals is a very expensive industry. So we want to kind of open up that market and create an open collar, an open source collar. The first one we're going to develop is actually with Ernas, the speaker you heard before. Luca is going to assist us with that. It's going to be an elephant tracker. We're already developing it. The first prototype is going to be tested in the end of March. And then we're going to publish it all on GitHub and bring in the community to develop it, bring on the quick releases, other add-ons that we want to have. And hopefully we can create a collar that is a few hundred bucks, which means a lot more parks would be able to afford to deploy them. If they can deploy them, we can collect a lot more data and we can translate that into more situational awareness and actually actionable intelligence is what they want, so they can improve their patrols. And if we can achieve that, then we can protect our natural world with the great and fascinating technology that we all have available to us and keep using it for the greater good. Thank you very much and hope you come along to join us.
Well, thank you, Laurens de Groot. Well, very interesting presentation. But actually, a very stupid question pops to my mind, but I need to ask it. What if the poachers start using LoRa when themselves? Aren't you just pointing out the animals to them?
There's always the possibility that poachers will start using advanced tools, or people ask, what if they hack the signal, or stuff like that. There's always possibilities that a poacher could identify the location of an animal or break into the system. It is very unlikely, but nowadays you can't say it's unhackable almost. So it's a possibility. However, the reality is that the poachers themselves in the field are not that sophisticated. So how poaching works is you've got the kingpins, which are pretty rich people or governmental people sometimes involved, and that ripples down to very local unemployed people that we sent into the field, barefoot most of the time. They have to survive for a couple of days, kill the animal, and be gone as quick as possible. They're not. We've already seen that, for example, the gateways and the solar stations, they're not very interested in messing with it because they don't want to be detected when they're in the area. They're really focused on getting that rhino, horn, or tusk.
Oh, okay. Well, it's just my hacker mind.
No, but it's a I mean, very often
you could just drive questions. Around with a signal receiver, and as soon as you find the LoRaWAN signal, you don't need to know it's an elephant or a vehicle, but you know there's something there, so you drive to it, and then you see it's an elephant or a rhino. But that hasn't occurred
no,
yet.
No, it hasn't occurred.
Okay,
it's very unlikely.
Yeah, sorry for that.
Okay. No, sorry, that's why I'm here.
Yeah, okay. Any other questions, comments, or interesting theories for Laurens? Or perhaps another question, how can people help you? I mean, I assume you have a sort of foundation that people can donate or...
Yeah, definitely. It's smartparks.org. And we got the tax exemption status in the Netherlands, in the UK, and in the United States. So bring it on. But also expertise and or connections with high net worth individuals or company that want to partner with us. Because we're unbiased about what we use. We would just want to have the best technology in the field that is available right now. So
here we have a large community of developers. So on the techie side, what do you need?
Well, we need for the application, we need the front and the back end developers. That's very interesting.
So if there's developers, please
come along and come talk to us. I've got one of our engineers is here. So if you want to talk really techie, then he's the guy to talk to as well.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions, comments, remarks? No. 3, 2, 1. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Yes. Bye-bye.